assembled today to celebrate the 173rd World Anesthesia Day, and this CGR has been arranged to depict the evolution of anesthesia over the time. And on 16th October 1846, 173 years ago, WTG Morton was the first person to successfully demonstrate ether anesthesia in a patient and with a good outcome. So what exactly anesthesiologists do? So most of us believe that anesthesiologists put people to sleep, right? Yeah. So if we are there only to put the put people to sleep, then what happens to a person when the chest is cut open and the patient is put on cardiopulmonary bypass? They go to the deep hypothermic circulatory arrest. When craniotomy is done, when the brain is taken out, and when the surgeon is operating under, near the vital organs, and when patient goes into the deep hypothermic circulatory arrest. So we are there, so this, who makes the difference there? So anesthesiologists are doctors who keep patients alive while surgeons do things that would otherwise kill them. So maintaining the life of the patient while the surgery is being done is our job. Putting them to sleep is just 1% of that. So did you know the National Institute of Medicine found that anesthesiologists are the only physicians as specialty to significantly reduce patient mortality? This has been published in the Institute of Medicine US Journal, 1999. And if you look at the issue of this Atlantic, the 50 greatest inventions since the wheel, and obviously out of medicine, we have got penicillin, vaccination, the pill, that is tablet which we use, and pasteurization, anesthesia is among that. This is the 50 greatest inventions since the wheel was invented. So coming to our talk, anesthesia from humble beginning to promising future. So earlier when anesthesia didn't exist, the earlier options for pain relief was 8 people holding the patient and while the surgery was being done on them. And there were other options, like when patient is howling, and some people used to give wine, some people used to give opium, some has even tried hitting them in the head and making them unconscious while they operate. So these were the options for the pain relief earlier. And what used to happen then was surgery was brutal and only to be undertaken in extreme life-saving circumstances. And surgery was considered to be a humiliating spectacle of the futility of science. Surgeons were considered a savage arm with a knife. Pain was an unavoidable side effect of surgery, and most surgeons operating in a pre-anesthetic era believed it was a vital stimulant necessary to keep the patient alive. Patients were often sat upright, unlike what we do now. Just look at it. Can we imagine doing surgery like this? In an elevated chair, braced and restrained. Surgeons too were apprehensive about cutting into living bodies, confessed to shedding tears and being physically ill before or after, describing that the walk to the operating room like going to the hanging. And very few patients were fortunate enough to survive. Majority died of pain, blood loss, and infection. These were some of the depiction which I can show it to you. So from there, how it started. 4000 BC, Sumerians used to have this opium poppy. They used it to make people go to sleep. And then we had 2250 BC, Babylonians relieved toothache with the henbane, that is Hyoscyamus niger. 1600 BC, and right even now, the acupuncture in China was being practiced, and according to Shang dynasty pictographs on bones and turtle cells. And there was one surgeon who used to, anesthesiologist who used to cause numbness to the patient for doing surgery. Then we had this in Homer's Odyssey, that the famous book, a Greek goddess Circe uses delirate herbs, that mandrogra, that is mandrake, and datura in a brew to seemingly transfer Odysseus' man into swine. In coming to India, Sushruta used cannabis vapors and wine to sedate surgical patients. And he also used herbs like aconitum, which will supplement sedation. And the surgeon, Greek surgeon, Emperor Nero Dioscorides was the first to use the term anesthesia and recommend mandrake boiled in wine to cause the insensitivity to those who are to be cut or cauterized. Hua Tuo in China performed surgery with his general anesthetic magician, a wine and herbal mixture. This is the first reported anesthetic administration in literature, where the general was playing chess while he was being operated on his arm. And Italian physician Theodoric of Lucca, he used sponges soaked in opium and mandrake for surgical pain relief. The Incas, the South American population, they used to have practice of local anesthesia. Surgeon used to chew coca leaves, and that those leaves were applied to the operating wounds, particularly prior to toughening for headache. And the South American were the first to use curare, which was the first thing which gave origin to the modern muscle relaxants. And this was the first agent which was ever tried, sulfuric ether, by Valerius Cordus. He synthesized the diethyl ether by distilling ethanol and sulfuric acid into what he called sweet oil of vitriol. Joseph Priestley was the first to discover air. That was, he found that oxygen, existence of oxygen and nitrous oxide and their use, and he was first to isolate oxygen. Humphrey Davy, he's published this paper on nitrous oxide and observes that as nitrous oxide in its extensive operation appears capable of destroying physical pain, it may probably be used with advantage during surgical operations in which no great effusion of blood takes place. And this pharmacist Frederick Sartener isolated a new substance from opium, which he later named morphium, which is the precursor of all the opioid painkiller which we used these days. And Henry Hickman describes carbon dioxide anesthesia for animals, which was not feasible. We know that. And chloroform was discovered independently by the USA Samuel Guthrie, Francis Eugene Sauberian, and Germany's Justus von Liebig at the same time. On March 30, 1842, Dr. Crawford Long authorizes James Venable for removal of neck cyst on Dr. Long. This was reported, and he was probably the first anesthesiologist, and he was National Doctors' Day is observed on March 30, 1991. So there was this practice of nitrous oxide parties in those days. People used to, as we know, the nitrous oxide is called laughing gas. As we, these days we go share, when we assemble with friends, we go to have alcohol. Those days they used to have nitrous oxide also. There used to be nitrous oxide parties. So Dr. Horace Wells went to one of this party in 1844. And he found that one of his friend fell down from stairs and hurt his leg, and he was not in pain at all. So looking at this this thing, he thought that maybe because of the nitrous oxide, this he has got this pain relief. And then he tried on himself inhaling nitrous oxide for his own dental extraction back in December 1844. And thanks to our dental colleague, W.T.G. Morton, Horace Mills, they were all dentists. The origin of anesthesia has happened from them. And Dr. Wells demonstrated nitrous oxide anesthesia for a tooth extraction near Massachusetts General Hospital, but the partial anesthetic was judged as a humbug. Then came William T.G. Martin, the first person who gave ether anesthesia successfully to any and did a public demonstration of it in 1846 on October 16. He was a Boston dentist, and he gave anesthesia to this patient, Edward Gilbert Abbott, and surgeon was John Collins Warren. It was around 10:15 a.m. it was administered, and he could demonstrate with his own device. He could demonstrate this is successful anesthesia and the surgery which happened thereafter. And then people say that gentleman, this is no humbug. And he named it Latian, and it was actually sulfuric acid. Then Professor James Y. Simpson, a Scottish obstetrician, begins administering chloroform to women for pain during childbirth. Before that, all women were supposed to bear the pain, and asking for the pain relief was supposed to be antichrist. So this was the thing that started then. He successfully gave chloroform to women for pain during childbirth, and chloroform quickly became a popular anesthetic for surgery and dental procedures as well. Dr. Charles Pravas and Alexander Wood, these men independently invented the hollow hypodermic needle, the precursor of the modern syringe which we use, which will be attached to an earlier invention. And it all started much earlier, actually. Dr. John Snow, which was a full-time anesthetic since 1847, he was a multifaceted personality, and he made anesthesia popular by administering obstetric anesthesia using chloroform to Queen Victoria for the birth of Prince Leopold and Princess Beatrice. And that's how people came to know about anesthesia, and it became further in use. In 1884, Dr. Karl Kohler, which was a Viennese ophthalmologist and colleagues of Sigmund Freud, introduced cocaine as an anesthetic for eye surgery. And cocaine is the precursor of all the local anesthetic that is being used these days. Dr. William Halstead used cocaine for the first regional anesthesia for giving mandibular nerve block with cocaine. And further on, it went on to be used for other nerve blocks. In 1898, Dr. August Bayer, which conducted the first spinal anesthesia using cocaine, and along with the first spinal anesthesia, the first PDPH case was also reported. And he also invented this intravenous regional anesthesia, that is Bayer's block. Dr. Frederick Hewitt administered chloroform ether mixture to the future king, Edward VII, tugging on the portly prince's beard to keep the royal airway open. He was the first to use a device to keep the airway open, and he was credited with that. The modern airway which we use is the precursor airway is the precursor of that. Then came the synthesis of various anesthetic agent, IV anesthetic agent. Phenobarbital was synthesized first in 1903. Then procaine was introduced as local anesthetic, and it was called Novocaine. And Dr. Dennis E. Jackson developed a carbon dioxide absorbing anesthesia system. In 1920, Arthur Goodell published his Eye Science of Ether Anesthesia, which is used these days. And his Goodell airway, which was proposed, modern airway which we are using is Goodell airway, actually, and it was discovered much earlier in 1920. And Fidel Pages did the first lumbar epidural anesthesia in 1931. Dr. Flagg added, and Jackson, he introduced the first precursor of the endotracheal tube. That was a two-piece metal endotracheal tube. And these tubes were inserted into patient trachea to provide a clear passage for air and anesthetic gases both to and from the patient's lung. This has made the anesthesia much safer and still being used. Like it's vital part of the anesthesia administration. In 1937, Professor Robert McIntosh, which was the world's first endowed chair person employed as anesthetic, and Oxford's Nuffield professor. So he introduced this curved laryngoscope blade here. So this blade, modern blade which we used, is uses still of the same format. Only thing is now we have a battery case attached with it. Gautmi modified and developed a number of devices, including a Gautmi folding vapor mask and anesthesia machine, which inspired the Boyle's apparatus. In 1942, drug form of curare, that was intercostin, were introduced, and that made the paralysis during the surgery possible. And succinylcholine was synthesized by Bovet in 1949 and released in 1951. Dr. Victor Goldman was the first to he synthesized this Goldman vaporizer, and that was the precursor of the modern vaporizers which we are using to administer inhalational anesthesia. So coming to our part of the world, coming to India, we have our own history. As we have seen earlier, so Sita was the first one who used to use wine, opium, and Indian hemp to provide numbness to the patient during surgeries. Of course, tying up was another thing he was doing. And Bose Prabandh of cranial operation, he performed a cranial surgery on the Raja Bhoj, that is himself, by using Samoni. It was this is documented, but nobody knows the truth of it. 1847, 22nd March, the first administration of ether anesthesia in India was done. And that was done under the supervision of Dr. O. Saugnesi, the surgeon, at the Medical College, Calcutta. In 12 January 1848, the first chloroform anesthesia in India was administered. And in 1890, after 20 years of accident due to chloroform, the world discarded it in preference to ether. However, in India till 1928, chloroform was the only anesthetic used, and it was the popular expression of anesthesia was chloroform. It was Dr. M.C. Gongli from Calcutta who observed the leniency of coroners, and Jyoti Prasad of Jodhpur produced a classical, well-documented paper on ether and observed that open ether is practical even in hot weather, like country like us, and at less cost. On 12th January 1925, Mahatma Gandhi was operated upon on 12th for an uneventful emergency appendicectomy, and Dr. Date administered open drop chloroform to him. And notable feature that happens, that electricity went off, and the torch was used, and surgery was done with torch and kerosene lamp. 1925, lumbar and caudal extradural analgesia were performed by Dr. G.R. Kokatnur at Belgaum, Karnataka. He had been doing that since 1925 with 40 to 60 cc of 1% Novocaine, with no risk in other cases. In 1929, the flax can was modified into a bottle, and it was called the KEM bottle, named at the hospital where it was discovered. In 1935, the first Boyle's apparatus arrived in Calcutta by ship, and it had fine adjustment valves, no pressure reducing valves, and watertight feed bottle for ether, a two-way stop cock for rebreathing, non-rebreathing, and shipway CO2 absorption, and four cylinders of 100 gallons of oxygen and nitrous oxide. The cost of all this included including custom duty and delivery charges, was 645 rupees. And in 1940s, thiopental was introduced in India by Dr. M.M. Desai and Dr. B.N. Sarkar from Bombay at G.S. Medical College, State G.S. Medical College. And Dr. Desai had the misfortune of being the first and perhaps the only anesthetist to die in a dental chair following thiopental given by his own resident. We started doing neurosurgery, anesthesia for neurosurgery also in 1941. And 1949, D-tubocurin was introduced. 1950, the first indigenous boy leaf rolled out of IOL Calcutta imported parts. By 1956, it was entirely manufactured in India, except the cylinders. 52, the first mitral commissurotomy was performed in at GS Medical College again with hypothermia and for ASD in 1953. First open heart surgery was performed in 1961 at BYL Nair Hospital, Bombay, using an indigenous reusable bubble oxygenator. A two-bedded ICU was started at KEM Hospital, Bombay, in 1962. The first documentation of an intensive care unit was in 1963 at Army Hospital, Delhi, by Colonel Rama Rao. At this time, there were units at AIIMS Delhi by Dr. Tandon, and at Sabdarjung Hospital by Dr. Abhijit Bhattacharya. Now there are ICUs in every town and ICUs in all major hospitals and specialties where anesthesiologists play an important role. These are the other landmarks. Discovery of various drugs. We have ketamine, bupivacaine, pulmonary artery catheter, etomidate, propofol. Discovery of the pulse oximeter and capnometer was the most important event that to ensure the safe anesthesia administration. And then we have got many drugs like sevoflurane, desflurane, sugammadex, which can be used for the rapid reversal of the neuromuscular blockade in emergency scenarios also. And since then, many technical advances have brought us from screams of pain to the deep silence of pain-free unconsciousness. The contribution of Indian anesthesiologists have been immense to the anesthesia side. We have the first female anesthesiologist of the world was from our country, Dr. Rupabai Pardunji. And the Mallampatty classification, which we used to assess the airway in the preoperative period, has been discovered by the Sesadri Mallampatty Rao, is from Andhra Pradesh. And the manufacturing of the first supraglottic airway device, that is the laryngeal mask airway, that was also that one Indian also played a very vital role in that. So how is the anesthesia practice these days? We have safe drugs, we have better medicines, monitors, and modern machines are very much safe to use and easy to use. We can understand them. And that has led to the safe anesthesia practice today. We have the anesthesia-related complications has gone down tremendously. The anesthesia-related deaths are very, very, very rare now. And most complicated surgeries, right from the open heart surgery, craniotomy, awake craniotomy, liver transplantation, be it complex congenital heart surgery like switch and double switch are possible because of the safe anesthesia administration. And the devices which we have got, the monitors which we have got, the development in the science through the research that has happened through all this year. So we have many new drugs in the horizon. We have propofol with less side effects, etomidate, dexmedetomidine, demifentanil, sugammadex, and we have xenon, which is coming up to be used. There are many monitors we play with to keep the patient safe. We have invasive monitoring right from the head. We can monitor the cerebral oxygenation. We can monitor the state of anesthesia based on the EEG. We have bispectral index monitor. Then we have invasive monitors. We have cardiac output monitor available to know the airway exchange. We have many monitors. We have entidal monitors. We have CO2. We have plethysmography monitor, which can be used. then neuromuscular blocker that monitors can also be used for the patient to monitor. We have automatic record keeping, which can to keep us medico-legally safe and to monitor beat-to-beat monitoring and can be done with that. Thromboelastogram to know the intraoperative coagulation status. That these days it's very commonly available in any institute which are doing major surgeries. And that can tell us about the intraoperative coagulation status, which product to be used, how much. And then we have this Massimo monitor, which will tell us about the instant hemoglobin values also to assess the surgery, surgical losses, and whether to replace and how much to replace. And ABG, we know, ABG bedside in OT, ABG, it's available with us also. Then we cell saver machines, which will, in case of massive blood loss, we can use them to salvage the cell blood and give it back to the patient. Ultrasound, we have been using very frequently now. Like we have, we can, right from the head, we can do ICP monitoring using optic nerve seat diameter. We can assess the airway, we can assess the, look at the heart using the transthoracic echo. We can look at the lungs. We can, in case of emergency pneumothorax, we can detect pleural effusion, pneumothorax, trauma, hemothorax. We have FAST and we have FATE, which we are using. Then to monitor the hemodynamic status, the IVC collapsibility, all these things can be done. Difficult IV access, central venous line access, and the giving neuroaxial blockade, giving peripheral nerve blockade, it's all been possible with the help of ultrasound. And obviously, the dedicated and well-learned anesthesiologists, that they form the major force of any institute and any anesthesia practice. So this has been the journey so far from the ether dome to modern days, which we are doing, and what we have to look forward to. So what we expect from the future, maybe the drugs with further improved safety profile, which will have less side effects, and which will be target-specific drugs, avoiding the systemic side effects, and maybe a complete anesthetic agents, which will we don't have to give multiple drugs to keep the patient. Anesthetic agents with sedative, hypnotic, muscle relaxant, and analgesic property. And based on the patient genetic makeup, patient's requirement, we can have a personalized genetically suited anesthetic administration, which can be modulated with microprocessor chip-enabled neuro-electronic interface at the patient. And what we need is ultra-rapid induction and awakening. Maybe a machine while switching on, the patient will go to sleep, and when we switch off, the patient will come out of the sleep. What else? Maybe environmental friendly inhalational agents like xenon, because these inhalational agents are the major contribution to the greenhouse effect and ozone layer depletion, which is happening. And the clutter-free, wire-free, Bluetooth control monitors, and these things are all near can be possible in the near future. These are many of the things are already available. So, increase accuracy of non-invasive monitors to replace invasive monitors. We can have artificial oxygen carrier, which is already chlorofluorocarbons are already available with us, which will have a higher oxygen delivery. We can save on the blood transfusion related complications. Maybe some clotocytes to enhance clotting and bacteriophages to kill pathogenic bacteria. Some robots and nanorobots helping us. We already have a robot which is Kepler intubating system, which helps us through that. We just have to toggle it and that can help us in intubating. This is a completely closed circuit anesthesia system. We have a monitor here. We have anesthetic depth monitor and vital sign monitor. And based on the anesthetic depth requirement and vital signs, the dose of the drugs will be adjusted. These things are already in the almost approval stage. hopefully common public will start understanding the role of an anesthesiologist. An A for anesthesiology will be taught in some of the kindergarten. And safe perioperative care to reach the poorest of the poor in the remotest possible place and the last patient standing in the queue, maybe that in the surgeon's list. Thank you. Now I invite Dr. Bhatia sir come to the stage. We have tried to make a compendium of the history of anesthesia, and that will be kept to preserve the heritage of it. That will be kept in our department, and it can be accessible to all of you. So we are planning to inaugurate that book today.
A question that is often asked to almost all the anesthesiologists is your only job is to keep the patient in sleep during surgery? I think the more appropriate answer could be, we keep the patient alive when the amount of trauma that the surgeon inflicts is 1,000 times more sufficient to kill a person. So that is the amount of injury inflicted during the surgery. We keep the patient alive probably is the better phrase to describe our job, not just to keep the patient asleep. The mortality has decreased tremendously to almost it's 1 in 2.5 lakhs, avoidable mortality, avoidable anesthesia mortality. And it is all because of good drugs, safe drugs, monitoring equipments, and good training of residents and all the anesthesiologists. But why do we need to know the history? What is the importance of history? Why are we discussing all these things? Unless we know something about history, probably we won't be able to appreciate what we have today, and we won't be inspired to develop it to a much better, safer level. Even today, anesthesia as a specialty is considered to be Six Sigma safety, which is almost 99.99% safe, which is considered to be the highest safety rating. So keeping in mind that history, all the PG should be aware of history, we took permission from American Society of Anesthesiologists, their museum, to reproduce this history book that they have, the photographs, and they have permitted, they are nice and kindly, they have permitted us, and then we'll make an e-book and then probably hard copy of it also. It will be kept in our library, in the department library, so that all the residents are aware of the history. So that is the importance of knowing history. E-book that we have been allowed to reproduce by the American Society of Anesthesiologists Museum. All and it's time to remember the history and celebrate the present, probably.
These are the glimpses of the book. Is still being used in ROTs. That will be all. Thank you. Any questions?
Good morning to everyone. A very excellent presentation of the history of anesthesia. So every surgeon will wholeheartedly thank you for every case and also for this day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mitsinger, for such a wonderful presentation. So one thing I would like to add that we are also thankful to Department of Dentistry, if we have any people from dentistry. So because Horace Welles, which is also one of the founder fathers of anesthesia, basically he was a dentist, and he gave first public demonstration for lateral anesthesia used for tooth extraction.
When W.T.G. Morton was a dentist.
So probably the origin lies somewhere in dentistry. And I would like to share one story that there was a dentist in Spain way back in 1500 something. So he had a friend who was having pain in his tooth. So every time he used to come, he said that it needs extraction, but he refused that. It's very painful. So one fine day, a monk was sitting next to him. So he came, he asked for the extraction. The monk advised him, ki, ask him to chew the coca leaves, contains cocaine, for a few weeks and then come back. So after a few weeks, when he came back, so he safely extracted a tooth without having pain. So from there, the origin of lignocaine came. So most of the surgeons were using local anesthetics. So they should be aware that it is, again, dentistry which gave the origin of local anesthesia, and then to physician practice anesthesia. So somewhere it is closely linked to dentistry also. Thank you.
Congratulations to whole of the Department of Anesthesia. And I think this is a wonderful presentation, because we are not aware of all these things. And thanks for apprising all these things. Most important is that there are some articles and some write-up also that anesthesiology has been compared to the airline industry. And they said that most of the innovations in the airline industry are also replicated in the anesthesia. And the checklist manifestos, the first opening line says that airline, they should go, the critical care also, medicine should go the way of airline industry. And I think innovations are occurring, and this has made the anesthesia more safe, the patient outcome better. And our institute, AIIMS Jodhpur, has also taken an initiative to develop the innovation cell. And there are many people, faculty members, who are member of that. We have Institute Innovation Council also. And yesterday evening, we have a long 3 hours discussion till 8 in the evening with the IT director about the new program, which is going to be introduced from the next year. That is the Masters in MedTech. So that will include both the medical people and the technology people, IT people together. And when the guides of the from the both the departments, and they're sharing the space between IT Jodhpur and AIIMS Jodhpur. So I think we can have the innovations, like we are talking about the Bluetooth wireless devices for monitoring, and the nanobots and other things. So I think this is all options. They appear to be a future thing, but I think with the help of our expertise, and I think the AIIMS Jodhpur has a more nurturing environment where we can develop all these things very well. The dedicated faculty and all this enthusiastic and passionate student, they can all help in developing this. So I think this is a very good, on this 16th October, you have a prize about the anesthesia day. It's good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for rightly pointing out, like airline industry, we can also, we cannot afford to make any mistakes, sir.
Dr. Mrityunjay, congratulations for a very nice presentation. And we surgeons are thankful that you keep the patient alive and pain-free and in control. And one of my senior was an anesthetist. He used to say that surgeon is the captain of the sailing ship and anesthetist is the captain of the sinking ship. But I like to believe that it's teamwork, and we are always thankful to you for the wonderful teamwork and being by the patient's side at the head end. It's very reassuring. Thank you.